And we touched on some characteristics. We've touched on aspects like holiness and reverence. We've touched on righteousness, peace, and joy so far, power, authority, and dominion, endurance and suffering, and extending forgiveness, stewardship. I was just thinking, you know, if we can incorporate all this as a believer, it would be so wonderful, right? Like if you had every believer in the city, every believer who's part of different churches, having this kind of a lifestyle. And it would be so much easier for the world to look at believers and say, oh, the people who believe in Jesus, this is how they are. This is what marks, these characteristics mark their lifestyle. Now, we do understand that people are growing. We are growing. I am growing, right, into what God wants us to be like and have that lifestyle. So we may not always find everyone in that ready state of living the right way. But the important thing is to know that we are God's people. And this is the standard which we have to set, even for the world to take notice that people of God, this is how they live and this is who they are. And I was also thinking, like, as a pastor, right, like with the experiences that I have had where you know, when you notice that people who are from the kingdom of light, they don't necessarily have the values of that kingdom of light. It's so disheartening and discouraging to come across some experiences where you hoped that the believer would make these kind of decisions, value-based decisions, but unfortunately that believer didn't, right? So that's very sad, even for us as other believers. But imagine how much more for God, that those who are part of the kingdom don't necessarily have kingdom values and kingdom lifestyles. So we should preach about the kingdom, yield ourselves to God, that we don't be those people who set the wrong example, right, for others. It'll be just so beautiful to see all believers growing into the kingdom lifestyle, having a holy life, making right decisions, so on and so forth. So that kind of discipling is important. Let's move forward. Let's look at some of the other characteristics here of the kingdom. The next aspect which is talked about here is about not being partial. So in the kingdom of God, we know that everyone who is born again, they are the children of God. Now, on the earth, some may have earthly riches more than others. So James, in his writings, he talks about those who come to the congregation or the gathering. You know, some rich people come and some poor people might be there as part of the church. And so he says in James chapter 2 that you should not have partiality. You must treat the rich person who walks in just the way you treat the poor person. Or rather, it's the other way around. So whatever you want to do for that rich person, you should be doing it even for the poor person. Don't discriminate on the basis of what people have to offer to us, right? But we treat everyone who's part of the kingdom equally. So that is another characteristic of the kingdom of God. And the application of this is manifold. I mean, I don't even have to talk a lot about it. It has bearing, particularly on social barriers that we may carry from our own cultures, right? But when people are part of the kingdom of God, we all are on level ground, okay? And that's the beauty of it. And James is encouraging the believers to maintain that. And he is also addressing those who could be in leadership, not to treat somebody who has a lot, you know, or who can favor you in some way and be beneficial to you in some way, treating that person with a preferential treatment and letting others down. That shouldn't be the value of a kingdom person. So we must follow this everywhere, right? Even in our churches. So we try to treat everyone the same way. Yeah, and there shouldn't be discrimination on the basis of wealth, social standing, or even gender. Okay, coming to the next value, kingdom value characteristic, is readiness for the king. Now there is again a parable, Matthew 25, which most of you would know about the virgins, five wise virgins and five foolish virgins, who were waiting for the return of the bridegroom. But five of them had oil, and when the bridegroom returned, they were ready to go meet him. But five others could not. Okay, and even though they wanted to borrow the oil, they were not given, because the wise virgins remarked that the oil wouldn't be sufficient for them and the foolish virgins as well. So what do we learn from this passage? See, basically this is a passage that talks about readiness. We are all waiting for the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. So while we are waiting, what should the kingdom person's lifestyle be like? So a kingdom person's lifestyle should be one of earnest desire for the return of the bridegroom. So that's what these virgins were doing. They were waiting. Now, if we are not waiting, if we are living our lives thinking, okay, you know, I just have the affairs of this world to take care of, and this is my 10-year plan and my next 10-year plan and all, without really thinking about what is it that God wants done here through my life, and you know, we are waiting for the return of Christ. So what should I be doing, knowing that that is a reality? We must not lose touch with the scriptural reality that the Lord Jesus is going to return. Okay, so there needs to be that earnestness in our waiting, in our seeking God, knowing that yes, Christ is going to come back. So keeping that in mind, what is the kind of life that I want to live? You know, what are the plans that I should have for my life for the next decade, so on and so forth. So first thing is to have that in our minds, that yes, the Lord Jesus is to return. Okay. And the second thing is to have enough oil. And oil refers to intimacy with Christ. So how can we have enough oil? No, when we abide with the Lord, right? When we abide with the Lord, and when His life is released into us, and we are living out of that life, okay, that closeness with God, then yes, we are able to release that oil in the form of our daily lifestyle, our testimony as a believer, our ministry, right, and what we do for others. So that intimacy will produce the results, and also whatever God wants us to accomplish for the kingdom's sake. So the oil is the intimacy. Two things here. One is readiness. Second is intimacy. So we maintain both of those things, and we live on the earth knowing that we have to establish the kingdom of God. We have to accomplish maximum for the kingdom of God, even though we are not necessarily from this world. Okay, so that's the lifestyle of a kingdom person, that we are in anticipation of the return of our king, and we are so close to the Lord, and our lifestyle is such, so connected to the Lord, that through that we are able to do whatever God wants us to do. So this is about waiting for the king, readiness for the king. The next characteristic here is celibate for the kingdom's sake. So this is similar to what we talked about in kingdom thinking, about having a resolve for the kingdom. But this is, you know, to another extent where Paul says that, you know, some people choose to become, he says, your eunuchs for the kingdom of heaven's sake. Okay, so by this he means committing their lives wholly to the kingdom, even to the point where, you know, they do not want to engage in your regular earthly patterns of even getting married and things like that. So celibate for the kingdom's sake. Now Paul himself, he wrote about this to the Corinthian. It's not mentioned here. This is from the reference which is given here is Matthew. Okay, but we know that, you know, Paul is a good example, and he wrote about marriage and also living for the kingdom without taking a wife, right? So he talked about being celibate for the kingdom as well. So in kingdom lifestyle, basically this is talking about commitment to a really great extent, where some may choose not even to marry, right? So yeah, that is very much part of the kingdom of God. Now for those who don't choose not to marry, even if people are married, it's about your resolve and the commitment that you have. Your marriage could be about the kingdom of God, right? So both husband and wife, like you have decided to extend the kingdom of God. So which is great, right? So that is based on kingdom value. Your family is for the sake of the kingdom. It's for the extension of God's kingdom. But this is mainly, the value is about having a resolve, having a commitment to a great extent for the kingdom of God, where we are willing to forego something that we may have the right to. So in Paul's case, I mean, it is said that because he was a part of the Sanhedrin, people who were part of the Sanhedrin were generally married men. So historians say that Paul was probably married when he, you know, when before he encountered Christ. But who knows, maybe his wife left him because he came into the faith, and that is what some of the historians say. But even after he came into the faith, right, scriptures, he says that I have a right to take a wife, but my focus is the kingdom of God, and I do not want to commit my time to other things. And, you know, in 1 Corinthians 7, he says when somebody chooses not to marry and only focus on the things of the kingdom, they will have lesser distraction. So Paul chose that route to commit himself completely to the kingdom and become a eunuch for the kingdom of God. Okay, so yeah, so this also is a lifestyle that we can have, that commitment that we can have for God. So with this, we have touched on what is mentioned in our chapter here, but, you know, there are several other values that we can have as part of our kingdom living. Okay, so any thoughts, any comments before we move to the next chapter here, which is kingdom culture? Okay, this is a question for Jean George, Rose. Yeah, but I can definitely answer you with what I know. So thank you for the question. So Rose is asking, what if in a situation wherein both partners married have outgrown their love for each other and they have a mutual agreement that they stay in union but prioritize things of God more? Yeah, I think while the outcome seems okay, Rose, like living for the kingdom, but I do living for the kingdom and prioritizing the kingdom. I see an issue here in that, see, the whole purpose of marriage, I mean, if there is, if it's not about, you know, love and understanding, then the core thing is missing, right? So if this couple has grown out of love for each other and they have a mutual agreement to prioritize the kingdom of God and live for the kingdom of God, they are missing on the actual, you know, actual basis for marriage. So I think it's important for this couple to maybe receive some counseling or get back to the Word of God, because living for the kingdom has to come from, you know, that place of love and agreement. What I mean, does that make sense, Rose? Or
yeah, Pastor, thank you. It's more on like because they've got children, so they'll stay in union and their company is more of friendship, but not on the romantic love anymore.
See, all those are like, even friendship, agreement, understanding, working together, it's all part of, it's all, you know, an essential part of marriage. What I'm saying is, but if, because you had mentioned grown out of love for each other, if that's the case, I think that needs to be resolved in addition to everything else, which is right.
Okay, thank you, Pastor.
Yes, yeah, thank you. Okay, so Charles, Charles has a question. Paul's thorn in the flesh, could it be his wife? Okay, Charles, I think in the prayer and intercession course, we have already answered this question, and we said that 1 Corinthians 12, the passage itself says that it was like, you know, a demon spirit, okay? And the thorn was not a human being, so confidently I can tell you it wasn't his wife, okay? So, yeah. Okay.
Ma'am, can I share something?
Yes, yes, Rupa, please go ahead.
On this kingdom values and looking forward coming of the king, I wanted to share an incident. When my son was, eldest son was 2 years old, I told him, Jesus is coming soon, we should be ready. Immediately he said, why are we not packing our bags? I said, no need to pack our bags. Then he said, he thought, wow, how can we meet our king without packing our bags? Then he thought for some a while and he said, so let us dress up for the king. Let us get ready for the king, because we don't know when he'll be coming. So it made me to think, and in spiritual terms, how we have to get ready for the, to face our king. Just wanted to share it, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah, wonderful thought there, Rupa. Yes, the clothes mean something, right? We are told that we are clothed with righteousness, clothed with holiness, then a garment of praise. Right? So in the spiritual terms, getting ready for the king means having all these things in our lives, right? And so much more. So yeah, that's good. Thank you. Okay, so any more thoughts about kingdom living? Okay, if there are no more questions or comments, we can go forward. All right, so yes, so let's move on to the next chapter here, which is chapter 6, that talks about kingdom culture. Kingdom culture has to do with a pattern of living once again. Now, if you look up the Greek word for the word nation, It is ethnos. Okay. And ethnos refers to a race or a tribe. People of the same race and tribe, generally, what unites them? It's their habits, it's their customs, their culture. So they have a certain way of doing life, which we can clearly see. Now, when it comes to us believers belonging to the kingdom of God, we are called, you know, so much has been done for us in Christ Jesus. So we've become so many things. We've become the sons and daughters of God. We are the redeemed of the Lord. So there are terms that we can use to describe whom we have become. But talking about kingdom culture, we will focus more on kings and priests. Revelation chapter 1 verses 5 and 6 tell us that God has made us kings and priests. Okay, kings are those who rule. They demonstrate authority, dominion. And priests are those who go before God, who minister to God. Okay, so there is the aspect of ministering to God and ministering to the world around us. So we have become kings and priests. And as kings and priests, so there is a certain culture that we can have that demonstrates the kingdom of God. So the affairs of this life, the way we conduct the affairs of this life, it is flowing from our connection with the heavenly kingdom. So we will look at some of the aspects of kingdom culture. Now, kingdom culture is based on values, it's based on the attitudes that we carry, it's based on some of the goals that we have, it is based on practices that we choose to follow, beliefs and behavior as well. Okay, and the beautiful thing is that we can be part of different literal nations, that term nations, which is ethnos, race or tribe. But when we belong to the kingdom of God, we have the beliefs in common, right? We have values in common. We have attitudes in common. We can also have goals in common, right? So just by virtue of the fact that we are part of the body of Christ, we share this kingdom culture. It's a culture which you could say supersedes our the culture that we have from our from our identity as certain nationals. Okay, and we are not saying that we are supposed to leave our normal culture, that we have from our nation. That's not the point. The point is that there are certain values that the Word of God talks to us about, and we incorporate those and we share them in common when we belong to the body of Christ. Okay, so now, once the people of God are born again, I already told us that we have to make a journey. And this is a journey of being discipled also. So, people of God need to be taught, equipped, trained, and moved into this pattern of living, this culture, okay, which they can adopt as their minds are renewed to what is it that God wants us to, how is it that God wants us to live. So we are going to talk about some of those key things in our chapter here. But again, there is so much more that we can actually talk about. And you're free to go and study about know, other topics from scripture. So what are some facets of kingdom culture that we should have in common? The first one is honor, a culture of honor. So obviously the word of God teaches us that we must honor God, we must honor the king, or you know, the rulership of the land where we have been planted, and we are also called to honor the body of Christ. We are called to honor the leaders in the kingdom of God. When it comes to those who serve in matters of word and doctrine, 1 Timothy 5:17, we are told that we have to treat them with double honor. Okay, so you would find this word honor in many places, and honor inviting us to honor God and leaders and people, you know, and just to base our lives on this value of honor. So how do we honor somebody? We honor them by genuinely speaking highly of them, by recognizing the right thing that they are doing or teaching, and also by following it, right? So when we follow leaders, we know scriptures talk about doing it from our hearts and doing it in such a way that they can lead us with joy, and not doing it hesitantly. Okay, so in all these ways, when we are yielding to the word of God, when we are walking in submission to leaders, we are actually honoring them. So we must maintain this culture of honor, and this is a kingdom of honor. Okay, where everybody must be honored. Now we also see in scripture, right? Like earlier when I talked about no partiality, we are being told that we must honor not just the ones who have, whether it's wealth or experience or something to contribute, but also the ones who may not have, because we've seen that in the kingdom of God, you know, even the least, they are honored. And it's amazing, because when you read about John the Baptist, okay, Jesus said this, that the person who is least in the kingdom of God, he is even greater than John the Baptist. Okay, so why did Jesus say that? Because John the Baptist did not have the opportunity to be like born again, because you know, he lived before the redemption of Christ. But what Jesus was talking about, he was talking about the redemption. He was talking about, you know, how men and women could enter the kingdom of God through the atoning work of the Lamb of God. So all of us who are born again now, in fact, Jesus said that if there's anybody, now we could term them as, oh, they are the least, that person is so new in the Lord, they don't have any experience, or look at their life, they are still not righteous. So we could look at them in different ways, but you know, we are told to honor even the least, right? So there is that equality that we share because of who we are in Christ, and of course, you know, we are encouraged to honor, especially those who are called as leaders and who serve in various capacities, particularly those who serve in doctrine and in the word. Okay, so it's basically a culture of honor, and we must have this in the way we deal with people. Okay, and pastor's added a note here, and this is about the honor that belongs to the fathers. Okay, so I just share that as an additional thought. So pastor shares how Elisha had double anointing, and he moved in double the number of miracles as Elijah. But still, when we are told about John the Baptist, we know that he came in the spirit and the power of Elijah and not Elisha. Okay, so Why is that? Like, the New Testament records that John the Baptist had that anointing. He carried that anointing. But the honor went to Elijah and not Elisha. Okay, so in a sense, Elijah is the father of, if you may term it, a new move of God. And God recognized Elijah over Elisha, even though Elisha did more things, you know, in terms of the miracles, like if you count it. So the point from this is that, you know, God also places honor on those who have served him well, who have paid the price, who have sown the seeds, right, who have pioneered fresh moves of God on the face of the earth. And God has a way of honoring them. So the way man honors might be different from the way God honors, but God places honor on the lives of people, and God sees the labor, and God sees the service. So that's a little bit about the culture of honor. I know there's so much more that can be shared about this, but as God's people, wherever, whichever country we are from, whatever background we are from, we receive this culture of living with honor, honoring God, honoring people, honoring leaders. Okay. Yeah, I know that revelation is awesome. Yes. Yeah. Okay. So culture of selfless giving. This is the next value for us. So basically, as people who are part of the kingdom, we are ready to give. Okay, we are ready to serve. In other words, we are ready to serve in whichever way. It could be our efforts. It could be letting go of our comfort. It could be in encouraging others. It could be in giving them some form of support which they need. It could be in providing finances if people are in need of that. So we give, right? We give and we serve. And obviously, as part of the kingdom, this is not supposed to happen by way of coercion or compulsion, but we need to do it from our hearts. And maintain this culture of giving and serving one another. And as we do this, God's name is glorified. And wouldn't it be beautiful if, this is how our churches are, and this is how the communities of believers are. Okay, and it's a kingdom culture, selfless giving, where we honor the people. We think of them more highly than ourselves. So we're ready to do whatever it takes to bless them. So kingdom culture is a culture of selfless giving. So, I mean, just a thought that I wanted to add here is when I completed my bachelor's and had some years of experience. I really wanted to go do my master's. So God gave me the opportunity to go to a different country. So I did my master's in Australia. And when I went there, I was very, very scared because I had a wonderful church here, like from APC. And to think that I will go to another nation and then find a church, have good people there to relate to. It was really like I was really praying hard and saying, God, please make it happen. I should get a good church. And sure enough, God gave me a wonderful church in the city that I studied in. And I always think of this kingdom culture. Right, so I went. I'm from another nation, and it was a multicultural church. So there were people from all different nations over there. But the culture, I'm telling you, was no different from the culture here in Bangalore. So same thing, the way they honored one another, the way they gave selflessly. Right, so I still remember as a student, I was trying to save money in the smallest things, right? Like, you don't want to eat anything fancy, don't want to wear anything fancy because you want to save money. So I was doing all that. And the winter came, and it was nothing like the winter that I know of from Bangalore, and it was super cold, and I did not prepare for it, so I didn't buy really thick jackets and all, and it was just getting bad. So and I'm always reminded, one day morning I opened my door, and the people who stayed, like, we had a shared accommodation, and there were four other girls who stayed in the same house, but one day morning and they were from the same church, by the way. So I opened the door, and there were these packets with socks, with jackets, with name it, like whatever a person needs to be warm in the winter. It was all there, and with all these cute notes of encouragement, and I literally cried. I was like, God, I'm in another country, and my family doesn't know what I'm going through, and there are people of God who are ready to give even when I didn't ask for it, right? And then on an ongoing basis, there would always be these lunch boxes with my name on it, right? And that was, I'm so thankful to God for people like that who are part of the community. But whenever I think of selfless giving, my memories just go back to my stay in Australia, how wonderful it was to be part of that community. Things that I would think of and think, oh no, I can't buy it, like I'm a student, I have to be careful. But even in church, I remember once I really needed, and it was summer now, and I needed some sunblock, and it was so expensive, the one that I wanted, and I was only thinking about it, I didn't even pray about it. Some random auntie from the church, one day after service, she came and she handed me a packet. She doesn't even know me, some Chinese auntie, and she said, I felt like God wanted me to give you this packet, and there's like food and this and that, and the exact sunblock that I wanted, right? So I mean, I'm like, wow, what is this culture? You can go to another nation, you can go to another place, but the culture is the same, right? The kingdom culture. So I mean, it's so awesome if we can actually live out whatever we are talking about. So just to make it more practical, I thought I'll share my experience. It's a really beautiful experience. Yeah, so more stories for later when we complete the portions. So moving on to the next aspect of culture here, daring faith. Okay, so daring faith simply means we are ready to take the risks. When God calls us to do something, pioneer something new, or it could be just making the next move in our service of God, we are ready to do it. Okay, and it's going to take daring faith, right? It's going to take daring faith to pray for somebody. It's going to take daring faith to go and release a prophetic word to somebody. It's going to take daring faith to move with the gifts of the Spirit. What if I'm wrong, right? So, but it's a culture of daring faith where whatever is required of us in that moment, we are willing to do. Okay, and I'm talking about some of the common things. But what if God wants us to go and plant a church in a particular place, some nation in the world? It's going to take daring faith, right? And we know the stories of so many missionaries who actually did that. They followed the voice of the Lord, and they went, they established a work for God in a new place. But it's a culture of daring faith where everyone who belongs to the kingdom, they're ready to do that. What about some kingdom business ventures, things that nobody has ever done before, but God is calling you to do it? It's going to take daring faith. So when you have every child of God, everyone who's part of the kingdom who's willing to step out and do what God is calling us to do, we see that same value uniting all of us, and God's name is glorified. So a culture of daring faith, culture of joy. Culture of joy means that we maintain the peace, whatsoever is good, the way Philippians chapter 4 tells us, right? Whatever is good, you think on those things. So we maintain the good things in our midst. We get rid of the evil, you know, the gossips, the slanders and everything. We just maintain a culture of joy, which again is birthed by the Holy Spirit. Now, culture of joy may not necessarily mean that everyone is laughing and smiling all the time, but it's also a sense of peace and calm assurance, dependence on God, trusting that, you know, God will see us through the difficulty that we are going through. So maintaining that culture of joy, you know, getting rid of all the aspects that suck up our joy, right? The negative words, the accusations, the division and all that, but maintaining a culture of joy. And the kingdom of God is supposed to be, supposed to have righteousness, peace and joy. So joy is a part of our culture. Finally, here the last section talks about a culture of heaven invading earth. Okay, so heaven invading earth means the power of God being seen in every way. The preaching of the gospel, first of all, because we are called to the Great Commission to go to the ends of the earth, make disciples, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, but also, you know, to see the manifestation of the kingdom, which would mean that those who are sick, they see the power of God released upon them. Those who may be going through attacks of the enemy, the oppression, they are delivered. Captives being set free, people receiving help in practical ways. So it could mean the poor receiving food, or you know, those who are in desperate need receiving the resources which they need, justice, right? So the kingdom of God is all of this. The kingdom of God is about helping the orphans, the widows. So the spiritual aspects and the practical aspects, everything covered. So basically, the culture of heaven invading earth. We are establishing whatever is in heaven here on earth. So that would be the culture that we must have as God's people and work towards, right? So we've touched on different subjects here, and I'm sure there are so many others that we can cover under this topic. So at this point, I think I will pause. Any more thoughts or questions that you want to add to kingdom culture, it'll be good to discuss that through. So, do we find it easy to establish this kind of a culture? Yeah, thanks, Samuel, for that comment. Okay.
Yes. Okay. Sorry, and thank you.
Yeah, go ahead, Maggie.
I say it's difficult to establish this culture because we grew up in different places with different cultures, and when we meet in the church, we still have our biases. We still have our like culture that's we grew up in still dominates somehow. And even in the church that I am in, I see the same thing, that some people are easy to share and to enjoy the heavenly kingdom. Others are still battling to understand. They're believers, yes, but they're not living in the culture that we're learning about now.
Yeah. Thanks, Manu. Thank you for sharing that. So, can I ask you a follow-up question to that?
Yes, you may, Pastor.
Yes. So then, what do we do, Mangi? If only some are able to live it out and the others are not, what should be done?
It's a difficult thing for personally to say, because trying to convince someone and trying to teach someone who is not, who doesn't regard you the same way that you regard them, or who don't, who a person doesn't see you the same way you see them, it's a bit difficult. So I think first of all, we need to become friends with them, then speak to them in the way of the Lord, in the way of teach them the culture of heaven, because trying to go to them and just say, no, you must do this, this is what the Bible say, you will end up creating division. So we have to cultivate friendship, and at the same time, after friendship, show them the way. Thank you, Pastor.
Yes, thank you, Mangi. Thank you. So, Mangi, like, if you are a, I'm just looking at this as a pastor. So if the individual is a pastor or somebody who is leading the congregation, then I think it's a little easier, because then, you know, we preach the word. So whenever we preach the word, the change will come. But that is the precursor. We have to put the truth out there and let the truth work. Okay, so then the change will come. But if we are not in the position of leadership, and we see the wrong culture, I think a good thing to do would be to pray, and to also see if you can address the matter with the leadership. Like, you could, you know, bring it to their attention and maybe ask them, because they are the ones who are responsible. Now, we don't want to, you know, try to do things opposite to what they are doing, right? So that's also there. So the way you present the issue while honoring the leadership is very, very critical. Okay, so just some thoughts that I wanted to share with you.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Okay, so there are some comments over here. We'll come to them. Rupa, you have something to say?
Ma'am, thank you.
Yes.
We have lived in many mission hospital campuses, and we have seen that kingdom values lived out, and it's so beautiful. It's just like a big family living together.
Yes.
Flowing into, just like the first church that was in built up in we see in Acts. And part of our growing up, while my husband was doing his PG in Vellore, we used to attend a church, Peniel Tabernacle. Their auntie and uncle, they used to leave out this type of kingdom values. It was like taking care of the church family as their own family, reaching out to all that we have seen, and it was caught more than taught. We were so blessed through their lives, and flowed out through our lives wherever we moved. And very easy in a mission and a Christian setup, but when we move to secular setup, it took few years for us to build that culture in the place where we are now working.
Yes.
But can be done.
Yes.
And focused on the King and his values, and we move out with compassion and see the need around us, I think it is possible. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Rupa. So what Rupa shared is an additional point to what Mangi was saying. So Rupa, yes, living it out also. So if I want to see a certain culture, I need to live it out. And that gets caught, right? In addition to being taught, and that way the culture will prevail. So thank you. Thank you for that. Some comments here in our chat. Prabhakar is asking, oil represents the presence of God. Can you explain that a little bit more? So oil representing the presence of God or intimacy?
Intimacy, sorry, I just tapped below. You said the oil represents the intimacy. Okay.
Yeah. So intimacy. Okay. So oil representing intimacy is, okay. So you see that like in the Old Testament, right? Whenever you talk about like the presence of God coming on somebody, usually you have this incident where the priest would take some oil and put it on them. Okay. So, so in that context, and also, I'm not getting the exact example actually. Okay, so Prabhakar, can I just get some scriptures and maybe answer that for you later, the exact
yes.
ones?
Yes, first.
Yeah, because that would be better. Yes.
Why I ask this is somebody said when Melchizedek gave bread and wine to Abraham, somebody said that represented the presence of God and the Holy Spirit. I mean, the Word of God and the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. So that way, I was thinking oil represented the anointing or something.
Mm-hmm.
But this was different. Yeah.
Yeah. So see, the thing is, any one thing can represent a lot of things. So oil does represent the presence of God. Oil does represent the anointing. But oil in this context is representing intimacy. Okay. But I just want an additional reference to give you. So that way I can clarify with regard to intimacy.
Sure, Pastor. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Yeah, and Tarun's comment here, such culture is contagious. It's like being salt. Not everyone need to comply to begin with, but everyone will get influenced by a few who start practicing it over a period of time. And yeah, very true, Tarun. It is contagious. Like you just get sucked into it, and that's what you want to do for somebody. So the class is actually over. So those of us who want to leave, have to leave, please feel free to. Since you don't have another class, maybe I'll share a few more incidents from my experience there. So like, because of that experience, right, of being taken care of really well by people of other countries, literally, right? So they were my brothers and sisters over there. I never really felt that I was in another country, okay? As soon as I came back, and this is something that I've learned, God prepares you for what He wants you to do later, okay? So I came back to India and then, you know, started working here. And at that time is when some volunteering opportunities started opening up with church. And I started attending APC North. And eventually, there were opportunities to preach and also, you know, to serve as a volunteer associate pastor over there. But the beautiful thing is that most of our congregation at APC North was African. Okay, so they were people from another culture. We had so many young people from Uganda. There were people who would come from Kenya, Ivory Coast. I don't remember the other countries, but at one point, I think the majority of the church was African, like even if you compare it with the number of Indians who used to attend there, because there were some colleges around the area. And several African students had come to study in those colleges, and that's how the church was packed with them. But then I realized, you know, the experience which I had in another culture, it helped me to look at my brothers and sisters here. You know, there was no difference. It was so easy to just get acquainted with them, mingle with them, and just be a part of that community. And eventually God gave me opportunities to lead also, right, in that congregation. But yeah, so that culture, what Tarun said, what I had experienced somewhere else, kind of became what I was able to do with others who joined in. So I think God kind of prepares you with the experiences that you have. Whenever we establish godly culture, it just gets carried from country to country, place to place. I think even if we feel that, oh, we are the first ones doing it in a certain place, you should do it. You should live for God, because that can have a ripple effect on the lives of people, and they will carry it wherever they go. Right. So it just came to my mind. So I'm sharing that experience as well. Okay. So yeah, well, I think with that we wrap up today's class, and please feel free to share your thoughts, questions on the stream section. And if you want to discuss anything more about kingdom culture, we can always do that in the next class before we move on to the next chapter here. Okay. So thank you, everyone. Thank you for your attention. Thank you for your time. God bless you. Hope you are enjoying the classes and learning a lot. Right. We will meet you again in the next session.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye. God bless.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye.